Shabbat Shalom, everyone.
Shabbat Shalom.
Today I'm going to be teaching from 1 Corinthians and the third chapter. From the Brit Kalasha, if you want to turn there, it is a good idea. You know why I encourage you to turn to the text and actually follow along? Because that way you'll know I'm not lying to you. That's actually what it says. How many of you are glad you're here and would rather be here than anywhere today?
Amen.
As I often jokingly say, I'd rather be here today than in the finest prison in America. Well, I'm going to talk about some things today, and I don't mean to be offensive. I was explaining to Karen and Robert that I used to be a pastor in the traditional church for quite a number of years, about 13 years of that as a Southern Baptist, and then other various non-denominational, interdenominational. I also served in charismatic circles, as well as you name it. Before I found my Hebrew roots and began to understand the truth of the Scripture, and let me refresh everybody's memory before I even get into the text today. Who wrote the Scriptures? Were they Hebrew or were they Greek?
They're Hebrew.
They were all Hebrew. What do you suppose their culture was? Greek or Hebrew?
Hebrew.
Hebrew. So they wrote from a Hebrew mindset and a Hebrew culture. And so we must understand that culture and that mindset, and we must take English or Greek back to the Hebrew before we can really fully understand what Scripture is talking about. This is what I'm going to attempt to do. I don't mean to be offensive, but I want to ask you something. If you claim to be a believer, but you are following after man's traditions and ignoring the word of the living Elohim, are you not fleshy? So what we have to do is get away from the traditions of men and get back to what Yahweh really said. Isn't that true?
Yep.
That's what we're going to try to do here. So I've titled this, The Carnality of the Religious System. I'm going to be talking about that today from 1 Corinthians, the third chapter. And so let's begin there. Follow along with me. Again, once again today, hold your comments and questions until after the teaching. And during the Midrash portion, I will answer any questions or comments, allow you to make any comments that you have. Meanwhile, please withhold them until that time. Who is speaking here? The church calls him the Apostle Paul. How many know that Paul is not a Hebrew name?
Right.
How many know that Jesus is not a Hebrew name? His name is Shaul, not Paul. The name is Yahshua, not Jesus. I'm going to repeat this again for the benefit of some that are listening. There were no J's in the English language until after the 1500s, and maybe after the 1600s. So we know that it cannot be Jesus, even in English. It's a nickname. Shaul says, "And I, brothers, was not able to speak to you as spiritual ones, but as to fleshly, as to babes in the Messiah." Shaul Shaul ended the previous chapter by saying, but we have the mind of Messiah. I would pray that all of us seated in this room, all of you who are listening on the internet today, understand that as believers, we must have the mind of the Messiah. We must begin to think as He thought, which means from a Hebrew culture. He was not Greek and He was not English. He was a Jew from the tribe of Judah. And so He thought like a Hebrew. He taught like a Hebrew. And so this is the mindset that we have to have. Consider for a moment. If we have the mind of the Messiah, should we not speak what He spoke? Did He speak on His own, or did He speak what the Father spoke? See, a lot of people have this misconception that Jesus, as the Messiah, just made up His own thing and taught whatever He wanted to teach. But He never did that, not once. How do we know that? Because I said so? What I say makes no difference, does it? Unless I'm saying what He said. Let's look at Yohanan, John, chapter 14, verse 10, and see what he says. He says, do you not believe that... Now, I want you to notice the next two words. Do you not believe that I am... If I stop right there, he just said a mouthful, didn't he? Do you not believe that I am? But let's continue. I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. The words that I speak to you, I do not speak from myself, but the Father who stays in me does His work. Yeshua just said, the Father and I are one. I'm in the Father and the Father is in me. And the words that He speaks are the words that I speak. I don't make up other words. I speak it as He spoke it. I don't know if you've ever considered this, but sometimes when we teach the Word, we have to be offensive. Because some people don't agree with the Word, but it doesn't matter whether we agree with it or not. It's what He said, isn't it? So I've come to the place where I don't worry too much about offending people if I'm teaching His Word. Because that's what I'm going to do. That's what I'm called to do, and that's what I'm going to do. Let's look again at Yohanan chapter 6, verse 63. Yeshua says there, it is the Spirit that gives life. Now let me stop there for a moment and kind of give you some food for thought here. If I didn't go any further with this verse, it says it is the Spirit that gives life. If I stop and said, what is the Spirit? Somebody would say the Holy Spirit. In Hebrew, it is the Ruach HaKodesh. The Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, that gives life. What is the Ruach HaKodesh? In the teachings of the church system, we had the three persons who made up something called a Trinity to them, which was the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, or as some people call them, the Holy Ghost. Amen? Howsomever, there aren't three, and they're not three persons. There is one. The Father manifested Himself as the Son, and He is the living Torah. And it is the living Torah that is in you and me. And the living Torah is Yeshua, the Messiah. And so when He says it is the Spirit that gives life, please remember, that the teaching in the Torah says that the word of Elohim, the Torah, is your life. And so he says it's the Spirit that gives life. The flesh does not profit at all. What does the flesh do for you? Nothing. It is a place for sin, a habitation for sin. The sin is always in the flesh, not in the Spirit. Then he says, the words that I speak to you are Spirit and life. So when we allow the Torah to speak to us, what are we ingesting? Life. We're ingesting the Torah, which is the Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, and with that is life. This is why one of the prophets was told to tear a page and eat it, swallow it, and told how sweet it will be to your taste. This is what he's talking about. Not literally take a page out and eat it, but study the words on the page, ingest them, and they will be your life. Yahshua shares with us that he speaks what the Father gives him, and that those words that the Father gives him are Spirit, Torah. We have learned as time has gone by that words are made up of letters. Even in English, if I just take a simple word, cat. Cat is made up of letters. Any word in Hebrew is likewise made up of letters. But here's the difference. If I take cat, C-A-T, and I take any one of those letters, it means nothing on its own. For instance, let's take the first letter, C. What does C mean? Nothing. But in Hebrew, if I took the equivalent letter of a C, and I pronounced it and said, chet. What does chet mean? Chet on its own has meaning. It means offense. Offense that surrounds or offense that divides. Mean? And that letter also has a numerical equivalent that means something. This is unique to the Hebrew language. Every single letter of the 22 letters of the alphabet in and of themselves has meaning. And each one has a numerical equivalent attached to it, which has meaning. And that numerical equivalent is going to agree with that meaning. Shaul tells us that he could not speak to the Corinthians, he says, as spiritual people. What is he talking about? If I'm going to speak spiritually to all of you, I'm going to be speaking truth to all of you. Am I not? Lies are not spiritual. Deception is not spiritual. So truth is spiritual. Truth was a foreign language to them. And I'm sad to say that for the most part, truth in the religious system today, to many people, is a foreign language. In fact, what does Yahuwah tell us in the Torah? He says, the time is going to come when people will not want to hear the truth. Would you believe me if I told you that we're pretty much there? People would pay for a lie rather than have truth for free. And it's getting worse and worse. When we attempt to share the truth from the Torah, for instance, we speak a foreign language to those that are in the religious system. Which is very interesting to me. I tried to share with a pastor right here in town. Actually tried to lay it out to him and show him from the Hebrew, where his understanding in English and Greek is totally skewed. You know what his remark was to me? I am not even remotely interested in Hebrew. Well, you will never understand Scripture. Never. You're going to understand how man has interpreted it. This is why. Now, I told you I was a pastor for years. I heard many times a person say, well, that's what it means to you, but that's not what it means to me. So I'm going to ask this question that I have asked many times. Do you really think that the creator of the universe, the creator of the heavens and the earth, gave us his written word so that you can interpret it one way and I can interpret it another way? No. I sincerely believe his intent was that we all would come to the place where we will interpret it one way. And this is also why in Zephaniah, he tells us this, that in the very end, we will all speak a pure language. I won't understand something differently than you will. You and I will be in complete unity. Can you believe that? Hallelujah. Can you imagine if all of us, even all the Messianic congregation, were in unity? We all were looking at the text and getting the same interpretation, not something different. How blessed would that be? Go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 2. I fed you with milk. Now, what is milk? What does Shaul mean when he says, I fed you with milk? If you don't have an understanding of the Hebrew culture, you're going to think he's talking about milk from a cow. And you're going to think he's literally talking about feeding you with milk. That's not what he's talking about. The milk is the Torah. So he is actually saying here, I fed you with the words of the Torah. And then he says, and not with solid food. For until now you're not able to receive it. And even now you are still not able. What does this mean? It means a person, I want you to get the picture of this. And I'm going to use this because I feel qualified to do so. If I took a person who's been going to church for, let's just round the figure off, say 20 years. They've been going 20 years and they have read their Bible every day. They have prayed every day. But they're not walking it out. To walk it out is the meat. This is the verb orient to do something. Remember the word says, be ye not hearers of the word, but be ye doers of the word. Right? Don't stop at just listening. That's insufficient. Listen with the intent to do, which is Shema in Hebrew. Shema. Shema means hear it with the intent of doing it. So when you hear us here talk about Shema Yisrael, it means hear what He is saying and prepare your heart and your feet to do it, to carry it out. I mean, but he says, actually what he's saying here, if I could paraphrase this verse, he's saying, you came, you listened to the Torah, but you still are not walking it out. You're hearing it, but you're doing nothing. This is what he's saying. I hope nobody in this room is hearing it and walking out and doing nothing with it. We are all expected to apply it, aren't we? To be fed with milk is a Hebrew idiom that means trained with simple teachings. Now, I've heard many years now that I've been in the Hebrew roots, many years that I have been teaching the Torah, I have heard so many times hear people say, well, keeping all those commandments, that's just too difficult. Nobody can do that. Nobody can keep all those 613 commandments. Well, I beg to differ with you that the Creator of the heavens and the earth says this, my commandments are not burdensome. So somebody is lying. I don't believe that it's the Creator of the universe. Now, what's the problem with the statement, nobody can keep all those 613 commandments? No, they can't. I am not a woman. So I cannot keep the ones that apply to women. That's not for me. I'm not a high priest. I can't keep the ones that are for the high priest. But I should and could keep the ones that apply to me. Just as you can. Keep the ones that apply to you. Again, Yahweh says these are not burdensome. These are not difficult. These are not hard to do. These are simple teachings. What does law mean? See, the church has misapplied that word that they see in the Old Testament about law. And they have learned to call it the law of Moses. It is not the law of Moses. There is no such word as law in Hebrew other than mother-in-law, father-in-law, sister-in-law. But law, no. The word is not law. The word is Torah. And the word means Yahweh's teaching and instructions. So if you tell me, I can't possibly keep that law, what are you telling me? I can't keep His teaching and instructions. I can't do His teaching and instructions. If I tell you that you are under the law, Christianity takes an offense at that. Like that's something horrible and dirty. You better be under the law because it's His teaching and instructions. And they say, well, we're under grace. We're not under the law. You better be under both. By the way, when the Scripture says that grace came with the Messiah, when did the Messiah come? He didn't come in the New Testament, did he? So grace didn't come with the New Testament. You see, grace is used more in the Old Testament than it ever is in the New Testament. Only people don't recognize it because it isn't the word Greek, G-R-A-C-E. It's the word favor. same thing. Hebraically, if you look it up, it's exactly the same word. It isn't different. Let's look at Hebrews 6, verse 1. Therefore, having left the word of the beginning of the Messiah, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of belief toward Elohim. So this is an elementary teaching, it's called in some other translations. Something I always wondered about when I was a pastor in the traditional church. And I used to ask myself this question, and I never had an answer. Why is it that Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, when I preach a message, I'm preaching a salvation message to a church full of people who are already saved, but I don't ever teach them how to walk with Yahweh? I don't teach them how to live. I just am, my whole focus is on getting people saved. And there's nothing wrong with that. So don't leave saying I said we shouldn't get people saved. It's not what I'm saying. But we should be concerned with what we do with those people after they make that commitment. We should be teaching them, how do I walk this thing out? Let me tell you this. I have heard, I couldn't tell you how many people in the church tell me, well, I walk with Jesus. Really? Where does He walk? Where does He go? What did He teach? They say things. They're empty and shallow. They don't even know what they're talking about. It's just something they've heard and they repeat it. And you and I need to have the wisdom of Solomon and be able to say, really? And ask questions. You say you walk with the Messiah. Tell me how you walk with him. Explain that to me. Because they really need to know, don't they? Because the only person they're fooling themselves is them. I mean? So we're not laying a foundation of repentance again. Shaul is saying, I fed you that. That was the milk. Tells you how to get saved. Now I want you to learn how to walk this salvation out. And we'll talk about that some more. Beginning. You notice there in Hebrews 6:1 it says, having left the word of the beginning of the Messiah. The word beginning in Hebrew is reshit. It's found in the very first word in Scripture. And Bereshit 1:1. Now I'm going to say this just for the benefit of our two guests today, because all of you, I would hope, know this. Reshit means beginning. Where was Yeshua in the beginning? He was with Elohim. He was Elohim. That's what it tells us in John 1:1. Yohanan 1:1. But look at Rashid. It means the point at which something starts, the origin or the source. What is the source of all salvation? The source of salvation is not ever in a man. I don't care what title he has or what his name is. I love all of you with all of my heart, but I cannot save you. You better be looking to somebody other than me. I love you. I love everybody. I'd love to see everybody come to the knowledge of the saving grace of the Messiah. But I'm smart enough to know that according to the Scripture, that's not going to happen. There will be a remnant. Part of that remnant is right here. The people that I'm looking at and some of those out on the internet. Milk is the foundational teachings of Scripture. The laying out of the path of salvation. It is designed to answer a question. I'll give you that question here in a moment. But do you understand what foundation means? We're here today in a building. These walls stand on a foundation. Before you can build on something, you have to have a foundation. If you're going to build a believer's life, first of all, that foundation has to be laid. And that foundation is the Messiah. We call him Yeshua HaMashiach. Yeshua the Messiah. Here's the question. In Acts chapter 16, verse 30. Then he brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Now the church, the religious system, don't really understand even what the word saved means. When they say, I'm saved, they really don't understand what to be saved means. For most of them, it means fire insurance from hell. But to be saved means many other things than that. It means to have victory over something. It means to be preserved from something. Saved from something, delivered from something. All of those things apply. But it isn't fire insurance from hell. It is Yeshua giving you eternal life and then using you as a servant for His own glory. For you to do something for the kingdom. When I was a pastor, I, as most others did, laid the foundation every Sunday. I talked about that a moment ago. Man, I was great at getting people saved. I tell you what, I couldn't tell you how many people got saved so many times so I couldn't count it, because they'd come to church Sunday after Sunday and come at the altar and, quote, rededicate their lives. You know why people have to rededicate their lives? Because they're never taught how to live their life. And they're out there thrashing around in the world, mixing things. Yahweh hates mixing. Do you know that? You cannot mix the things of the world with the things of a true believer. They have to be completely set apart and different if you're a believer. There's no real teaching on how to walk out salvation with fear and trembling. There's a passage of Scripture that addresses this very, very clearly. Here it is. Shaul, again, speaking to the Philippians, says this: "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence," look what he says, "work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." So when you got, quote, saved, there is an expectation that you're going to walk out this saving experience with fear and trembling. You're going to go out and make a difference for the kingdom of Elohim. And it isn't about impressing people. It's about giving the truth. But you can't give the truth until you live the truth. You can't teach the truth until you know the truth. How many of you ever heard this in the church? The truth will set you free. You ever hear that? The truth will set you free. How many of you know that's a lie? Yeah. And that's not what the text says at all. The text says you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Amen? You don't know the truth, it'll never set you free. I learned as a pastor that people in the religious system are great at quoting parts of scriptures without the whole thing. For instance, let me give you another example. I heard this all of my life in the church. God inhabits the praises of His people. Not what the text says, beloved. Because they don't want you to hear the last part. Yahweh inhabits the praises of His people, Israel. Isn't that what it really says?
Yes.
And who is Israel?
Us.
See, our mindset is, if you're not born in Israel, you're not Israel. If you're not a Jew, you're not Israel. Well, let me tell you, that has nothing to do with where you're born. It has nothing to do with whether you're a Jew or not. It has to do with whether you have a relationship with Yeshua the Messiah or not. Because Scripture teaches us that if you have a relationship with Yeshua the Messiah, you are of the seed of Abraham. You are Israel. Everyone in this room, if you have a relationship with Yeshua, you're Israel. You may be Hispanic. You may be Jewish. You may be from one of the tribes. But you're Israel. Me? Solid food is wisdom. Shaul said, "I can't feed you with solid food." Wisdom. The wisdom is to walk out the Torah. Wisdom begins with the fear of Yahweh. What do you think, and would you agree with me, if I said to you, one of the most serious convictions against people who say they're believers today is they exhibit no fear of Yahweh? This morning I was watching a program. I love to watch these religious programs on Saturday mornings because they make me mad. when they make me mad, it stirs up my juices and gets me to really pressing on. You know what I mean? I heard somebody say something. He said, he was on a program and he was going to beg for money like they all do, right? Planting a seed in their ministry. He tells this guy that's in charge of the program, and he says this with a straight face. Well, the Lord told me just this morning that if I would pray right now, that the Lord would impress 20 people to give $1,000 in the next 10 minutes. You know what I have to say about that? I'm sorry, but I don't believe him. Because that is not found anywhere in the Torah. Is it? That is baloney. Psalm 111 verse 10 says, the fear of Yahuwah is the beginning of wisdom. All those doing them, and notice that, what did I just say? All those what? Doing them have a good understanding. His praise is standing forever. You see, everything in Hebrew is verb oriented. Everything in Hebrew is not about what you think and what you believe. It's what you do with what you believe, how you walk out what you believe. If you told me, well, Jim, this is what I believe. I don't care what you believe. You don't care what I believe. It isn't important what we believe. What is important is what we do with what we believe. How I apply what I believe. Because the way I apply it tells you whether I have a relationship with the Most High or not. And what you do with what you believe tells me whether you have a relationship with Him or not. Because we're either going to walk as sons of disobedience, or we're going to walk out and live a Torah lifestyle, aren't we? I don't want to single out the religious system. I don't want to make them a bad guy, because there are some in the Hebrew roots who cling to fleshly teachings also. We're not immune from that at all. All of us must surrender the pablum diet and move on to solid food. We have to give up our baby food. Finally, we get to verse 3. Shaul goes on to say, for you are still fleshly. For since there is envy and strife and division among you, are you not fleshly and walking according to man? To be fleshly means to walk outside of the Torah. To live your life outside the boundaries of the Torah. How do I know those who are fleshly? I just told you a moment ago. Their fruit reveals it. Scripture tells me, by their fruit you shall know them. By what you do and what you say, what comes out of your mouth, reveals your heart. Because the scripture says something to the effect that as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. So a person can claim to be this great believer, but if what he is saying out of his mouth or the way he is living his life, that's his fruit. Does it agree with what he's saying from his mouth? It's seen through jealousy, quarreling, and being divisive. Boy, I'll tell you, I have seen my share of division. And I'm going to tell you this. I'm going to be honest with you for just a moment. I've actually seen more of it in the messianic move than I ever saw in the church. I have seen much more division. Disagreements over the least little thing. And somebody gets a chip on their shoulder and walks out the door. There's no reason for that. Because we should be able to sit down and out of love talk to one another. We have to love each other. And I'm going to tell you something. I said it last week. I'll say it again. You don't have to like me, but you have to love me, because that's what He commanded you to do. Okay? And I love you. I have to love you. Some of them, I love you with joy. Some of the others, maybe you won't love me that way, but you have to love me. You may not like me. Walking. He says, they're walking this way. It's halak. Halak in Hebrew means a lifestyle that is lived or walked. What we do at Britomy is we try with all of our heart to walk according to what the Word says. We try desperately to do that. Do we do it perfectly? No. The only person I know that ever did it perfectly was the Messiah. But if the Messiah lives in me and through me, then He's walking it out with me. Do you understand what I'm saying? And He's teaching me every day of my life how to walk. If you go home and you say, well, I'm only going to read my Bible on Sunday. Only time I'm going to go to any kind of a service on Sunday, maybe once in a while I'll go to a Wednesday night prayer meeting. If you're reading the Bible, and that's all you're doing, may I suggest you throw it in the garbage, because it won't do you any good. And you're never commanded anywhere in Scripture to read the Bible. But you are commanded to study to show yourself approved. Don't read the Bible. Study. When you sit down, get yourself some reference material. Look up words. Learn what they mean Hebraically so you know how to apply them to your life. Now, if you really want to start doing that and you don't know what to do, get with me and ask me, and I'll help you. That's what I'm here for. I'm not goody-two-shoes. I'm not patting myself on the back. I know you don't have the time to devote to study like I do, because it's my sole job. But I come over here and study Monday through Fridays, Monday through Thursday mostly, and I sit here and study 4 or 5 hours a day. I don't read the Bible. I have reference material that I spread out. I research words. I look at what they mean in Hebrew. I apply them to the text Hebraically. And I share them with you on Shabbat. And I'm not unique. You may not have that much time to do it. But I bet everybody has time enough to do a little bit of it. Even if you didn't do but one passage a day. You just took one verse a day and said, I'm going to study that one verse. That's better than nothing, isn't it? To study one verse is better than reading 20 verses and not doing anything with them. When I look at the commandments, which the religious system claims to keep, I see only man's traditions. I see no real obedience to God's word. First Corinthians 3 verse 4. For when one says, I am of Shaul, and another, I am of Apollos, are you not fleshly? What is Shaul saying here? You're following men. My prayer is that you don't come here Shabbat after Shabbat and listen to what I say and take that as being the absolute foundation and truth. I'm sharing with you the foundation and truth, but you need to open and study on your own and make sure what I'm telling you is true. Do not believe anything that I tell you just because I told you. You listen to what I tell you, go back and look at it and say, yep, he's right. Or if I'm not right, then please do me coming to me saying, I looked this up. This is what you said, and this is what the scripture says. And if you correct me, I will admit that I am wrong. Okay. You are not of Jim or Brad or Rico. You are of the Messiah. Following a man is fleshly. Verse 5. What then is Apollos? And what is Shaul? But servants through whom you believed as the Master assigned to each. How many times have I shared with all of you that some of you call me Rabbi, some of you call me Jim, some of you call me other things. Okay? However, the one thing that I hope you consider me to be is a servant. I am your servant. I may be the teacher here, but I'm not as important as you are. I am your servant. I am the servant of the Most High. I am the Messiah's servant. But please bear in mind, I am not over you. I am below you. I am your servant. That's what he's called me to be. Teachers are not to present themselves, but rather to present Yeshua. Verse 6. Joel says, I planted, Apollos watered, but Elohim was giving growth. Teachers put the seed in the ground. I don't believe there's a single one of you sitting in this room that have ever heard me say, plant a seed in my ministry. None of you have ever heard me say, plant a $1,000 seed. Or even a $5 seed, or any seed. Because Scripture says the seed is the word, it's not money. There's only one seed. I put the seed in the ground. I teach. That's putting the seed in the ground. Another may water it, but it's Elohim who brings forth new life. When we teach, it behooves us to examine the soil before planting the seed. I plant the seed. You are the soil. Listen to me carefully. If I go to plant a seed in the soil, I need to ascertain whether or not the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, has gone on before me and prepared the soil. Because if not, I'm wasting my time. And I'm wasting His time. I look for people who are hurting, people who are crying out, people who want this walk. So many times I have shared with Christian people, and here's what I get. I express a truth to them, show them from the Torah, and I hear these words. That is so interesting. Well, it better be more than just so interesting. It better be something that you want part of. Something that you want desperately. Okay? You want to live it. You're starving and hungry and thirsty for it. And you want it. These are where I want to put my seed that I teach. Okay? And I hope you do too. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is any at all. But Elohim gives the increase. And he who plants and he who waters are one. Each one shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. I may plant the seed. There may be another teacher come along and water that seed. Now let me ask you this. If he doesn't water it, what happens? Let's look. It says we are one, the one who plants and the one who waters. That word is echad, echad, a unit within the whole, a unified group, a single quantity. I want you to pay close attention now to the last part of that Hebrew definition. This is a Hebrew definition. How many in the room are familiar with Strong's Concordance? Okay. Strong's Concordance is good. But when you go in and look up a word in order to see what it means Hebraically, do you know what you're getting with Strong's Concordance? You're getting a Hebrew definition from a Western mindset. You need to get yourself, listen to me, you need to get the ancient Hebrew lexicon of the Bible. The ancient Hebrew lexicon. The reason is it gives it to you from a Hebrew culture, from a Hebrew understanding, and not from Strong's Concordance. Strong's Concordance is good. It is a help. But don't stop there because it doesn't really give you the meaning. Okay? But look at a single quantity. Echad means a single quantity. If Yahweh says, Yeshua and myself, we are one, we are echad, what is he saying? We are a single quantity. What does that mean? It means one. One means one. If I fail to put seed in the ground, there will be no harvest. How many of you know that? If you want to be part of the kingdom and part of the harvest, you need to start putting seed in the ground. If I put seed in good soil and another fails to water it, there will be no harvest. What happens to seed in your garden if nobody waters it? It doesn't die and new life doesn't come. 1 Corinthians 3:9, for we are fellow workers with of Elohim. You are the field of Elohim, the building of Elohim. Remember I said the foundation is the Messiah? Yahweh builds you and me up on the Messiah. We're one in Messiah. We plant the seed into the soil of those to whom Yahweh is building. So if I don't plant the seed, somebody doesn't water the seed, how can Yahweh build a life? You see what I'm saying? And when I was a pastor, I used to plant the seed all the time and nobody watered it. And so what happens? How many of you are familiar that a lot of people come to the altar, give their life to the Messiah, and within a month or two you never see them again? They're gone. It's because they don't know how to walk the walk and how to be faithful. According to the favor, there's another word for that, it's grace, or into the grace or favor of Elohim, which was given to me as a wise master builder. What made Shaul a wise master builder? Was he just inherently that smart? He learned the Torah. By the time he could recite at his bar mitzvah, he knew all five books of Moses by heart. He was Jack Van Impe of the modern era. Okay. I'm joking, of course. He says, I've laid the foundation, another builds on it, but each one should look how he builds on it. This is something that if somebody's going to build on the foundation, they need to examine how they're building on it. If you're just teaching people how to tithe and how to give and how to meet the needs of your ministry, that's not what it's all about. It's about how to make this person so that they're prepared to be a part of the kingdom of Elohim and can contribute to that. Out of His goodness, Yahweh called me to teach His Word, to build a platform whereby one could have a relationship with the Most High. That platform was the foundation of Messiah upon which another might build. So you might not stay here. You might have to move or something. Somebody else might come here to be the teacher. Somebody else might take over here. And then I would hope he'll build on what we've laid here. Joel cautioned subcontractors to follow the pattern as they build upon the foundation. Subcontractors I'm talking about are people who come after me and teach here. Those are what I would call subcontractors. If you follow the pattern, you can never go wrong. For everything that Yahweh intends for you and me to do, He has provided a pattern. There's a pattern in Scripture. I want to share with the two of you, real quick, just something you need to know. You saw us do the worship here. As far as I know, there may be others, but I'm saying as far as I know right now, I'm the only rabbi, the only teacher in the Hebrew roots who has people come and do what we did for worship. The rest of them are still saying praise and worship. They're combining them and they're up like this and they're rocking back and forth to the music and singing songs. And nothing wrong with that, except that's not worship. That's praise. And how do I know that? Not that I'm that super intelligent. But if I take the Scriptures and I look up every single word that it talks to me about worship, I will find that in the Hebrew, that word is shechah. Shechah means to kneel, to bow, to prostrate yourself. Doesn't mean with your hands raised, doesn't mean singing, doesn't mean dancing. That's all praise. And that's all great and beautiful and it has its place. But when it comes time to worship, you are on your face, kneeling or bowing before Him. And I'll guarantee you this, if He walked through that door right now, where do you think you would be? You'd be on your face. I can assure you that you would be. So for everything that I teach here, I have a foundation, a pattern for. Look in Revelation. When they're around the throne of the Most High, what are they doing? They are bowing before Him, aren't they? They're not standing. It says they are bowing before Him and worshiping. Right? Isn't that what we should be doing? When we are teaching, we must use His blueprint. His blueprint. We are not allowed to re-architect His plan. We do it His way. How many times have I preached this, Lee?
Often.
Bunches. Verse 11. No one is able to lay any other foundation except that which is laid, which is Yahshua, the Messiah. You and I can't lay any other foundation. Let's look at the religious systems that are out there that have laid different foundations. If we take the one that's most prevalent in this state, okay, what foundation have they laid? Joseph Smith. Okay? If Joseph Smith is not a true prophet, their whole belief system collapses. Okay? And just look at any of the others that are out there. If we build a foundation, a belief that says, we should celebrate Christmas. No, we don't. Christmas is nowhere in Scripture. Yeshua, the Messiah, never celebrated His own birthday. Show it to me anywhere in Scripture. No one, no apostle, no Talmudim, nobody ever celebrated His birthday. Because December the 25th is not His birthday. December the 25th is the birthday of a pagan who was born on December 25th. Amen?
Amen?
So we're building a belief system on something other than the foundation of the Messiah. And yet we're claiming that it was built on Him when it isn't. Easter is one of the most hellish, unbiblical festivals there ever was. And has nothing to do with His resurrection. A foundation in Hebrew can have three different meanings. You may want to make note of these. Foundation in Hebrew can have three different meanings. Here they are. It can have the Hebrew meaning here, which is yatsag, to leave something, to put something in place. Natan, to give something, or to make a present, to present a gift, to grant something, to allow or bestow by formal action. And the third one is sim, means a place. To put or set in a particular place, position, situation, or relation. Now, are you going to need me to leave that up there for a minute?
Please.
Yeah.
Okay. And when you have copied this and you have time, go back and look at your notes and see how this fits the Messiah. Or how the Messiah fits these three meanings. And remember, He is the foundation. And bear in mind that the teachings are posted on YouTube. Should be up and running tomorrow. So you can always go into YouTube and look at these teachings over and over and over. So if you fail to get something here, then it's always on YouTube. You can pick it up tomorrow. Good to go?
Yeah.
Now, given those meanings, it should be evident that each refers to the Messiah. Here's the way it works. He was put in place to allow us to have a relationship with Him. Almost daily, I hear TV preachers laying a new foundation for living that is inconsistent with a Torah lifestyle. I hear it all the time. Now, I want to say something here, though, because it sounds like maybe I'm being condemning or being the bad guy here. I'm not saying that they do this because that's what they want to do. I'm saying they do this because they don't know what the text really means. When I was a pastor and I was preaching and teaching, never one time did I think I was deceiving somebody or lying to somebody, and they don't either, and that's not what I'm saying. But it doesn't matter whether that's what they intend to do or not. The end result is the same. If you're not taught the truth, then you're taught a lie. Mean? And if you misapply it to your life, then it's meaningless. I know they have good intentions. But any of you ever hear the road to hell is built with good intentions? And it would do good to remember that. Huh? If anyone builds on this foundation, now listen, with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, and straw. I used to read these things when I read my Bible and didn't study. And I'd read that and think, so what? What does that talk about? What does that mean? Well, it does mean a lot if you understand Hebrew. Gold and silver and precious stones and wood were building materials used in the construction of the temple. How many remember that? Hay and straw were used in Egypt to make bricks. So what is he talking about here? How you're building on the foundation. How you're building your temple. Not the temple in Jerusalem, but the temple that is in you. How are we constructing our own lives today? Are we building a temple for Yahweh or making bricks for Pharaoh? Are we following Yah's pattern for life or Pharaoh's life of slavery? What are we doing? Joel continues, each one's work shall be revealed, for the day shall show it up, because it is revealed by fire. And the fire shall prove the work of each one, what sort it is. How we build on the foundation of Messiah is most important. The work we do will be revealed. Here's the word revealed, as it means in Hebrew. It is the word or. And or means to be or to give off life. Light, I meant to say. Light. Fire will prove each one's works. This fire will be a consuming fire. Hay, straw, and stubble will be consumed. You remember my teaching that there are two types of fires spiritually. One is a consuming fire. One is a cleansing fire. You remember that Moshe, stood before the burning bush. The bush was on fire. But the bush was not being consumed. It was not burning. And out of that bush he heard the voice speaking to him. That was a manifestation. This should help you understand Yeshua the Messiah. How many know that Scripture really doesn't teach that he was a man? It says he came in the image and likeness of man. It says he was manifested as a man. Just like the bush was manifested as a burning bush, but it did not consume. Manifested means a lot. And I'm sad to say there's not nearly enough teaching on that as there should be. Mainly because people don't believe it. Verse 14, if anyone's work remains which he has built on, he shall receive a reward. Well, hay, wood, or hay and stubble is not going to survive, right? This reward that we get, if we've used the proper material in our construction, our temple, it will remain. What is this word here, yashah? To remain means to stay in a dwelling place for the night or long periods of time. We will receive a reward, a sheker, a wage, the reward or price paid for one's labor. We're going to stand in a bema seat before the Messiah. And there we're going to receive a reward. This is what the Scripture tells us. Here it is. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 10. For we all have to appear before the judgment seat, that's the bema seat of the Messiah, in order for each one to receive according to what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. You're going to be judged regardless of whether you did good or you didn't do good. How well have we built this temple that's in us? What have you taken into this temple that we should never take into a temple? Let me ask you this. Do you think that eating kosher is still applicable?
Yes.
Do you think if it was wrong to eat pig back then, that it's still wrong to eat pig today? There are misapplied scriptures where certain people would say, well, you pray over it and it makes it clean. Nope, as I have jokingly said for many years, I can take a pig, scrub it, spray perfume on it, put a ribbon around its neck, circumcise it, and it's still a pig. No matter what I do with it. You cannot cleanse what he has made unclean. And you cannot uncurse what he's cursed. Have we followed Yahweh's pattern as we built on the foundation which he's laid? What do you do when you've done something all your life and thought it was okay, And now you're faced with the truth and you say, well, now what do I do? Do you continue to do that, or do you say, okay, I've got to stop what I've been doing and do it His way? I've got to follow His pattern. That's what I do. That's what I did. Man, I used to love, probably better than most of you, a nice big pork roast. And butterfly pork chops. But He says, that's not food for you. And I'll tell you why it's not food for you. If you don't believe me, check it out. Go to where they are slaughtered a pig. Has to be fresh, slaughtered. Take a piece of that meat, put it on a plate, take it and pour Coca-Cola on it, walk off and leave it for about half an hour, and come back and look at it, and you'll never eat pork again as long as you live. It's dirty, filthy meat. Its job is to scavenge the earth. Worms crawl out of it. It's filthy. Keep in mind at the Bema seat, now listen, this is important. Keep in mind that when you are at that judgment seat of the Messiah, when you're at that Bema seat, we're not going to be judged according to our salvation. Our salvation is secure. That's not an issue. But it's our works. Remember we talked about walk out your salvation with fear and trembling? How well did we walk out our salvation? How well did we do the works that He's commissioned us to do? This is what's important. That's what we are going to be judged on. Philippians 2:12 says, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now not only in my presence, but much more in my absence. Remember this, I read it a while ago. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Notice what he says there that's really interesting. As you have always obeyed. Paul's talking to people here. He says you've always been obedient. That's important. So should we. Obedience to the Torah is the evidence of a genuine salvation experience. When someone comes and tells me this, I'm saved, but I don't have to keep all those commandments. Then I would say this, then you have no evidence that you've ever been saved. I'm not saying you weren't. I'm saying the evidence is not there, so how does a person know whether you're saved or not? You see what I'm saying? Christians often say something about the finished work of Jesus. Anybody ever hear that? What was that finished work? What is the finished work that they talk about? They would say dying on the tree, dying on the cross. Is that the finished work? No. He has finished the work of salvation, but He did not finish our need for obedience to His own word. He was obedient to His own word, and He didn't need salvation. He was and is salvation. You see what I'm saying here? I hear all the time all this talk about the cross. Now, again, please understand, I'm not being offensive here. I'm just trying to share a truth with you, a Torah truth. Torah is not about death. The cross is a symbol of death. If you go out and drive down the highway, you'll see crosses on the side of the road where someone's been killed, right? People wear it around their neck, hanging from their ears. It's a symbol of death. But the Torah's not about death. Yeshua's death was important to us. I take nothing away from that. But please remember this. He said that if He doesn't be raised from the dead, you are still dead in your sins. He died on the tree, but He just said something. What did He just say? But if I be not raised from the dead, you remain in your sins. So I would rather take that symbol that's up there on that blue thing up there, which is life. That's a symbol of life. I would rather wear that around my neck than to wear a symbol of death. We are about life, not death. Yes, he died on a cross. He died on a tree. Shed his blood for you and me. But if we don't understand there was a pattern for that, why did it have to be that way? Because that was the pattern he gave in the sacrificial system. The sacrificial system was nothing but a picture of what would happen with the Messiah, who would be the lamb of the sacrifice. And you know, we teach on that all the time. So if you don't understand it now, and you keep coming here, you will. Because this Torah is a cycle. We teach it over and over and over and over. So if you don't get it now, you will get it and you will understand it. Verse 15, if anyone's work is burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, but so as through fire. So remember what it said, you're going to stand before him and be judged according to your works, whether good or evil. Oh, you're saved, but what if you did bad things? That part's going to be burned. So you're going to be tried and tested through fire. It's a cleansing fire, not a consuming fire. Here is the proof of my statement. He is judging us by what we did with what we believed. I hope you get what I'm teaching here. If I believe something, it can't just be in my head. It has to be a heart belief. It has to be a core belief. But the only way you're ever going to know that I truly believe that is when I walk that out and you see the evidence in my walk. Our hay, straw, and stubble may be burned, but our salvation remains intact. I haven't lost my salvation. This fire is not consuming, but a cleansing fire. It's a fire of purification. Malachi 3:2. How many people are familiar with the teaching of Malachi? I was asking my wife this morning, tell me if this is true, brother. If you or I teach on anything from front to back in the Bible, okay, front cover to back cover, people may not know what we're actually going to teach or preach about unless it's Malachi chapter 3. And what do you think they're going to say we're going to teach on? Give us some money. Amen. Malachi 3:2. And he who is able to bear the day of his coming and who is able to stand when he appears. For he is like the fire of a refiner and like the soap of a launderer. And he shall sit as a refiner and a cleanser of silver. And he shall cleanse the sons of Levi and refine them as gold and silver. And they shall belong to Yahweh, bringing near an offering in righteousness. So we're talking about a cleansing, our purification process here. Do you know that you are a dwelling place of Elohim and that the Spirit of Elohim dwells in you? Now let me ask you a question here. Why is it that the predominant religion in the area here spends not thousands but billions of dollars building temples all over the world? When the Most High says these words, he does not enter temples, does not honor temples, rather, built with human hands. So why are you wasting your time building them? The temple he's interested in is right here. It is in you and me. He says, if anyone destroys the dwelling place of Elohim, Elohim will destroy him. For the dwelling place of Elohim is set apart, which you are. Did you get that? You are the set apart place. In you is the menorah and the showbread. The whole thing. What does Shaul mean when he speaks of being set apart? What does it mean to be set apart? There's the word. The concrete meaning here is a feast. To be set apart then is a feast. the participants of a festival who gather and dance in a circle. Now, how many of you would have gotten that from set apart? Some people interpret it by this word, holy, right? Be holy. But that's not what Scripture says. See, this is the danger of English. Remember in the New Testament it says, be holy even as He is holy? But be careful of that. Because you're looking at words translated from Greek text. And in the Greek, listen to me, holy doesn't always mean to be set apart. Holy in the understanding of the Greek can also mean to be warmed by the sun. That's talking about sun god worship. So be careful with that. That's why you need to go back to Hebrew. But here, to be set apart means to participate in a festival. What festivals were we commanded to keep? Were we ever told to keep Christmas or Easter?
No.
New Year's, Mother's Day, Father's Day, any of these man-made things? No. The three main ones were what? Passover, Shavuot,
Feast of Tabernacles,
or Sukkot. How many know that Pentecost was not the beginning of the church? How many of you know that Pentecost did not begin in the book of Acts? In fact, it's mentioned in Leviticus, and it's also mentioned in Deuteronomy and probably other places. Obviously, Shaul is not speaking to those who gather on Sunday, Christmas, or Easter. He is speaking to believers who keep the Moedim, the feast days and the true Sabbath days. If a person is not set apart, listen to me carefully. If a person is not set apart, he cannot enter the dwelling place of the Most High. Is that a true statement? My brother here has studied the Torah for many years, okay? If you are not set apart, you will not and cannot enter the dwelling of the Most High. That is important. Verse 18, let no one deceive himself. Hey, you're not ever fooling Yahweh. How many of you know that? You're going to say, well, I'll just sneak this by. He won't ever catch me. He's already caught you before you even do it, right? He even knows the mind and thoughts of man. He even knows that your heart is to do evil continually. You just deceive yourself. He said, if anyone among you seems to be wise in this age, let him become foolish so that he might become wise. The person who seems, here's the word, seems, to think something. To plan or design a course of action, an item or invention. So what am I saying? A person who schemes to make his own pattern, to follow his own pattern of life and not follow Elohim's pattern of life. This is the one who fails to follow Yahweh's pattern. This person wants to change the blueprint and write his own Torah. Essentially, this is what the church has done. And when I talk about the church, I don't care what label you put on it. Okay? I don't care what you call it. LDS, Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, Catholic. By the way, all of them are essentially Catholic. Now, I know some people don't want to hear that.
It's true.
Where do you think Christmas came from? Catholicism. Easter came from Catholicism. And yet all of them do it, don't they? Man must put aside his own way, destroy his own blueprint for life, and choose Yahweh's blueprint for life. Proverbs 14:12 says, there is a way which seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death. So you either choose life or choose death. I mean, that's the only two choices you have. Spiritual success is solely based upon obedience to the written word, the Torah. His teaching, His instructions. Until this is understood, Man wallows in his own pig pen of stupidity and failure in life. Wisdom. Chachmah. This is one of those where you gotta clear your throat. Chachmah. What do they say? Speaking Hebrew is like spitting and snorting or something like that. Chachmah, which means wisdom, means skill. It means the ability to decide or discern between good and bad, right and wrong. You know, I raised four boys. And I can tell you this. They are masters at trying to convince you that they don't know the difference in right and wrong. But I can also tell you this as a father. With a little bit of advice on the seat, they quickly learn what's right and what's wrong. Spare the rod, spoil the child. Now I'm probably going to get lots of emails saying I'm espousing child abuse. No, I'm not. I'm saying that Yahweh gave us all a padded rear end for a purpose. Yahweh says that our ability to discern or decide something on our own is silly. Face it. He is smarter than we are. Allow the Word to discern for us. Make decisions based on the Word. Verse 20. And again, Yahweh knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are worthless. Who are the wise in this passage? Could they be those who see through Greco-Roman eyes? To the Hebrew, their thoughts are worthless. For instance, do you realize that a Jewish person does not remotely care what you believe? Unless they see what you do. You can tell them, this is what I believe. They don't care what you believe. Because it doesn't prove anything. I can believe one thing, you can believe something totally different about the same thing. So then, let no one boast in men, for all belongs to you, whether Shaul or Apollos or Kepha, or the world or life or death, or the present or the future, all belongs to you. And you belong to the Messiah, and Messiah belongs to Elohim. You see that? That is a pattern. You see that? You have Yahweh, you have Yeshua, then you have you and me, and then all the stuff, right? Don't be a meathead or be carnal. Be obedient according to His Torah, follow His pattern, and you'll live an abundant life. Till we meet again, study to show yourself approved. Shalom. Aleichem.